So, all right, everybody. So we are very pleased to have Professor Karniadakis here today. He's the Charles Pitts Robinson and John Palmer Barstow Professor of Applied Mathematics and Engineering at Boston University. He's a fellow of multiple professional academic societies, including the AAAS, SciM, American Physical Society.
That link that you sent on the email.
Mechanical engineers. His awards include the SciM ACM Prize and Computational Science and Engineering.
What are the email you sent me? You had, right here.
Somebody has the mic open. The Alexander von Humboldt Award in 2017, the SciM Ralph E. Kleinman Award, the J. Tinsley Olden Medal. As most of you know, he's one of the pioneers in the field of scientific machine learning, senior author of a number of influential papers in the area, including the highly cited physics-informed neural network paper. And on a personal note, George has been very receptive, supportive of our work here at Texas A&M in scientific machine learning. And I'm very glad that he accepted our invitation to give the Distinguished Speaker Seminar today. So thanks, George. The floor is yours.
Thank you very much. Can you hear me, Ulysses? Can you see under my screen and can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you and I can see you. Yes.
Okay, thank you very much for the opportunity to talk with you today. And I know we all come from different backgrounds, so I would like to start with something that we all have in common. That is, we drink coffee, and I don't know how many of you had the same question like me, but I was always interested in seeing how fast the aroma of an espresso in the early afternoon will hit my nose. And so that's a project that you cannot easily ask funding from the federal government. So I was able to convince, however, this company, LaVision, to do a lot of experiments for us. And in fact, you can see here the setup.
Come back. There's a talk I want to do. Can you come back at about 2:30?
Can you mute everybody? Okay.
Yes, I'm trying to do it now. Yep.
But,
anyway, I was just saying that for this important problem, we convinced this company, German company LaVision, to set up an experiment. It's a 3D slider photography, if you know what that is. It measures gradients of density. So they were able to give me this video. And now my task was, of course, to solve this very ill-posed problem. Namely, can you infer the velocity field and the pressure field in 3D and time, given only this video? Okay, and I'll show you later that that's possible, but this sets the stage of what I am thinking of, because a lot of real world important problems are like that. So I want to kind of basically give you an idea of what I had in mind about 6-7 years ago, what I was thinking about physics informed learning. It was not to replace the standard finite element solvers. I've been working all my life on high order methods where we know lots of, we know the physics, we know the PDEs, we just have enough data, clean data for, if you do applied mathematics, not so clean if you do engineering, for the boundary conditions and the initial conditions. However, as we all realize, more often than not, we are in this middle category where we know some physics and we have some data. We may not even know the boundary conditions. We may not even know, have a well-posed problem, just like the one that I show you, but we have some data. Even if we know in some cases, and I'm thinking, for example, the problem of turbulence, we know the equations, but we cannot go that low in resolution. Even with exaflop computers, data could improvise and have a synergistically physics and data working together. And there's a lot of other problems where weather, for example, would be like that. We do know the equations, but it's so complex, or complex systems or systems of systems. or social systems, for example, we don't know any physics, but we have lots of data. So we can treat these more complex cases. Even if you know physics, you can treat these complex cases as black boxes. And you try to identify those black boxes. So this is what I'm going to talk about today. I'm going to talk about physics informed neural networks. And I'm going to talk about DPONETs, which is operator regression and a new class of neural networks at the operator level. So with pins, we're able to integrate data and neural networks and physical laws. And I would like to show you how simple pins are. So let's start with a standard neural network. For those of you who have never seen it, it doesn't really matter because it's so simple. It's a least square exercise. You have some data. You expand the unknown solution in terms of some nonlinear basis, which is continuously changing. This base has weights. These are simply weights and biases, just part of the basis that is being updated. And by the mismatch in the least square error, you can, of course, use another norm. These days, we are developing meta-learning techniques to learn actually what norm is appropriate for what problem. But in the simplest form, you have this mean square error that you're trying to minimize. And by bringing back this iteratively with backpropagation, using automatic differentiation for the partial derivatives, you obtain all the weights in all these connections that are shown here schematically. So it's very, very simple. A high school student can do it. Now, of course, in science and engineering, we don't have 10,000 measurements we need for regressing a function. So, but we have conservation laws. We have conservation laws. We have Newtonian mechanics. We have reactive transport that we can write down some equations. So we can ask, we can insist that this solution that we're trying to fit also satisfies a corresponding conservation law. Here, for example, would be the nonlinear 1D Schrödinger equation, which, as you can see, I have written it in a parameterized form. I just need to have a manifold on which to minimize my function. So I want to make this function f, which is the residual, as close to zero as possible. And therefore, I have another mean square error term, which, of course, I will try to combine it with the first one in this form. So I'm going to have like a lambda data, a Lagrangian multiplier here, and a lambda physics. Okay, so if you get to this point, then you call some optimizers that the commercial machine learning community is using, and you're done. Now, what simplifies this approach, what is key, and that's what we introduce, is the automatic differentiation, the same technology that TensorFlow is using to and Google to propagate the error. We use the same thing to compute all the derivatives, and therefore we totally remove the tyranny of the grid or elaborate meshes, which of course are very difficult and time consuming, especially for engineering problems. So I want to demonstrate this concept. So let's say we're trying to solve this. So we start now at t equals zero. The objective is 10 minutes later to obtain solutions. So we define with TensorFlow here, we define the neural network. This was I will show you on the left. Then I have to compute the residual, which is also five lines. Now x and t are never discretized. These are continuous variables. And I have some points. My data will be somewhere here where all the black crosses are. That would be this term here on the that I call the data term. But notice that here I was supposed to have boundary conditions, but I have gappy data. So that's okay because the way this problem is formulated is different than the classical well-posedness for parabolic PDEs and so on. So that takes care of this data. Now I also need to evaluate this residual. Where would I do that? I will do it at random points in my continuous space-time domain. You can be clever and you can use a better distribution of points and so on. But the bottom line is, if you don't know anything, you just take 10, 20 points there. You have the boundary to compute the residuals. And 10 minutes later, as I said, you get solutions like that. If you don't believe me that it's so simple, I'll demonstrate in a second. Of course, there are lots of enhancements. One practical enhancement is, especially for multi-physics and multi-scale problems, is this extension where you can combine the classical domain decomposition, where you can have one domain and another domain. So for the same problem, now I take arbitrarily two domains, the dolphin and the blue sea. The blue sea, maybe the dynamics there is very simple. So you can use, let's say this will be two and this will be one. This will be a network assigned to domain two, and this will be a network assigned to domain one. So different neural networks, which could be tuned separately and so on. How do you stitch the solution together? You look at the residual. The residual has to be C0. And therefore you can just communicate, you can penalize the residual from domain two and domain one at these boundaries at the red line, and you get good solutions, as you can see. For those of you who work in domain decomposition finite elements, you see the stresses, for example, are always, or derivatives of the solution are always wiggly at the interfaces. Here you have a seamless integration. So of course, this gives rise to parallelization and so on. So this is a very practical method to use in practice. The community has picked this up because, as I said, it's very, very simple and you can get results very quickly. And when I say the community, not just the DOE labs, the DOD labs, the industry, especially the industry, I work very closely with industry, but also the students. So I want to show you this high school student from the state of Texas, Jeremy Wu. He's a 17-year-old. We gave a talk to our group last week. So you see, he took the loss function. He said, why don't we also penalize the loss, the gradient of the residuals, because you can compute them again with automatic differentiation. So then he did what is called a gradient enhanced pin. He was doing an internship at MIT for the summer. Of course, he's a high school kid who knows a lot about Laplacians, differential calculus, multidimensional. It's not your typical one, but certainly he wrote a paper, 40 pages on this, which is the latest paper on enhancing pins. The framework is, of course, is simple. The original method has lots of problems. The idea is maybe powerful, but lots of problems. So the entire community, as I said, is pitching in to make this method more powerful. So one idea that I found very interesting, in fact, very creative, it goes back to Ulysses. And here I have, I refer not to the original Ulysses with a Trojan horse, but actually Ulysses, my host today, who came up with this idea of tackling the stiffness that the physics could bring in and which will stall the neural networks by introducing weights, self-adaptive weights, which are trainable weights in the loss function. And by doing that, you basically can identify not the physics of the problem. You can, these weights, of course, are trainable, just like the weights and the biases of the neural network. These weights, which are Lagrangian multipliers, in front of the various contributions to the loss functions are trainable. So you can find his paper, I think, on the archive, or it may have been published. So since he gave a talk to our group, I wanted to show you some results that we've done. Since he's my host today, I wanted to show you this example. So let's say you're looking at this fourth order equation now, and you can see here, this is a loss function. This will be the physics, this will be the initial condition, this will be the boundary condition. So you basically introduce weights, as I said, but these weights are now weights at all the points where you enforce this. So you have a bunch of weights, maybe thousands of weights for lambda naught, lambda e, and these now are variable weights. So there's, you just add those as parameters, trainable parameters that you can find with the steepest ascent. But very similar technology as before, so you don't have to change a lot. It's a very, I always find that the simplest ideas are the most effective ones, and I think this is consistent with the spirit of pins. So this is a problem that is not very easy to solve. With pins, the error is relatively large, as you can see here. You can bring the error down with just and also compute faster the solution. The other thing that I like a lot about it is that if I look at just the weights, of course, they are changing in time, but they track the solution. This is time, you can see second order derivative in time. So we have waves everywhere bouncing off. You can see actually here, you can see that the weights follow the physics. You can see the solution on the left and you can see the weights on the right. In some sense, you can think of this as the inherent eigenfrequencies or eigenmodes in the system that you can discover on the fly. And that's why the interpretability is also important. There's certain problems, and I think in their paper, Ulysses and his student pointed out that the standard pins, of course, there are other ways with the X pin perhaps could solve this problem. But again, if you use this self-adaptive weight, the vanilla pin will not give you any solution. And here the self-adaptive pins give you excellent solution. And again, if you look at the solution and if you look at the weights track nicely the time evolving solution in this Alan Kahn equation. Okay, so I wanted to go back to 3 years ago when we were thinking what to do with this and can we solve ill-posed problems like the coffee problem. So at the time, I challenged my postdoc with the following problems in fluid mechanics. What happens, in fact, what I gave them, it was not this, I gave them a drawing of Leonardo da Vinci. If you don't know, Leonardo da Vinci was also a great scientist and he was interested in fluid mechanics and he spent lots of his time going to the rivers, little creeks, watching how the flow goes around the little stones and a lot of his paintings, I discovered, are in the New York library. And because I used a couple of his paintings and my idea was to use visualizations. What can you extract from visualizations? Of course, Da Vinci's were static, but what happens if you have a video like that? If you could just have a video of the clouds, what can you say about it? So this is a case, we have a flow that goes around this object, and then I observe something in this, I observe the dye visualization, right in this arbitrary topology of a flower, let's say. Can I infer from that the primary variables I'm interested in, the velocity field and the pressure field, using this type of idea, solving sort of the inverse problem? Because in pins, the inverse problem, the forward problem is exactly the same, same code, same formulation. You just have more data and you're trying to discover the physics in some sense. So you can see here on the right, what I have is the first equation, the first residual will correspond to the passive scalar. Then it's really the equations I'm interested to solve. I don't know the Reynolds number, I don't know the speeds. I don't know anything about the pressure, no boundary conditions. But wherever the dye goes, I can actually find solutions there. So you can see here, I have velocity and temperature. And if you even want to have the force on the body, if the dye goes around the body, like I show here, you can compute the forces just from smoke visualization. So that's kind of interesting. That was also surprising. In fact, what we did, we create a video from Da Vinci's some vertical flow, and then we say, okay, this is what Da Vinci was actually was able to visualize exactly 500 years ago. Okay, so going back to my fixation with this problem of espresso, they gave us something like this. The gradients of density is a little plume. And we were able to, this is in 3D, I just visualized in 2D. I was able to match the temperature pattern and then the process, I also find the pressure and I find the velocity field, which was verified independently using experiments. So I want to thank. The reason LaVision listened to me is because in the beginning of the pandemic, one of the researchers, Thomas Berg, is my now collaborator, he put a video on YouTube where he was puffing with the mask and without the mask. And using again the same technology, this Slirin photography, Slirin imaging, which is very, very old technology. It was used in the 60s a lot in high speed aerodynamics, for example. Here now it's used by everyone. But anyway, as you can see here, we isolated this small picture and we wanted to infer using this hidden fluid mechanics. We want to infer the velocity field and the pressure field around his nose. So we have a couple of different ways to do it. One is classical method, more classical method called optical flow, which gives you the velocity, not continuous. It doesn't give you the pressure. Our method will give you the pressure. You can see here, this is now a pressure distribution time just from that path that you see in the video. And then we also obtain continuous velocity fields, which of course satisfy the physics unlike any other method. So it's not just an interpolation method. We satisfy the physics. So in some sense, you interpolate using the physics and you satisfy the constraints of divergence free and so on. Overall, we found that, for example, the initial flow speed will reduce by 10 times if you wear your mask. This type of method is agnostic to applications. A lot of people in astrophysics use it. People in geophysics use it a lot. I think in the upcoming conference in AGU, there's hundreds of papers on pins, different developments. An interesting application is to use this inverse pin, so to speak, to examine the for non-destructive evaluation materials in general, to look at cracks, voids, inclusions in materials, and develop technology that does that fast using these robots, as you can see. So I'm working with some groups from Air Force and also from Europe to do that. I want to show you a hackathon that was put together a couple of years ago by DARPA. There were about 12 teams, and the problem is there's a, I don't know if you can see it, but there's a very tiny crack, surface crack somewhere, let's say in the wing of an airplane. And then you have this ultrasound that you propagate. The ultrasound will create this this diffraction wave, but you sort of know where it is, but you don't know exactly the size, its severity, and so on. So they asked 12 teams that do neural networks to see if they can characterize fully this surface crack in this real material. So most of my colleagues, all of them, complained that they had too little data. I told them we have too much data, so I throw away 90% of the data. I only kept 10% of the data. However, I use a pin. I use a pin because I know what the physics is. The physics is a simple wave equation, as you can see here, second order wave equation. The difference, of course, is that the speed of sound is a function of X and Y here. So if, and it's unknown. If it's a homogeneous material, that's a constant that has been, if you look at the NIST tables, at the National Institute of Standards, you will know what the speed of sound for that material. However, here we have a non-homogeneous materials. This is a function. So if it's a function, I know my pins can discover a function. So I assign to it a neural network. So this neural network that I have circled here is actually a speed of sound. So giving the data, only 10% of the data, I can find the speed of sound and therefore where the zero contour is. So basically I discover the speed of sound. You can see it here. It's almost constant everywhere, but as you approach the crack, I have exactly the zero contour of this function will give me the crack. So I have a new way of identifying the crack. What you see here is the real data, is this video. It's a slowly moving front. And of course, what I do, the data, again, is the imaging, is the image data. And by doing that, I can discover, I can transfer this knowledge into computing the C velocity, and therefore I know everything about the shock. So this is just one example. You can apply this to metamaterials. Imagine you have an electric field, you have these two materials, which we don't know it at their permittivity at all, but we know we have some measurements downstream here, which is the electric field. So knowing the electric field downstream and knowing the equation, you can figure out what is the material upstream. In other words, you can figure out the permittivity fields, as you can see here, with relatively good accuracy. Well, at the same time, while you're discovering also this permittivity, and you can compute also the field here. So this is what our pins can do for this case. As I said, pins is interesting. Lots of people are interested in industry. About this project, I will talk about the library later. There's a whole alphabet of pins. I want to to solve PDEs, stochastic PDEs, and so on, fractional PDEs. I want to, for the interest of time, I want to skip some of it, which I plan to do the stochastic PDEs to talk about and some other methods where you learn from the functional priors. I will skip that because I want to go to the second part, and I don't want to overload you with too much material. Okay, so let me just start with this one. So imagine you're trying to navigate an autonomous vehicle like this in the Atlantic Ocean. Okay, so if you were to do simulations of this, it will take about 1 week to simulate this destroyer in the Atlantic Ocean. Okay, because you have waves of 20 meters and so on. So how can you do autonomy using numerical methods? That's not possible. So we said, can you actually develop methods using neural networks? In this case, because the input is a stochastic function, the output is a stochastic response. So we're really looking about functional approximation. So at the time, I was teaching a class, and I didn't know if I can approximate neural networks quickly, and I can approximate them with functionals. So I looked at on the web, and there was all sort of contradicting answers. And then I found this jewel paper by Chen and Chen that was actually published in IEEE paper, as you can see here, in 1993. The same time that there was a universal approximation theorem for functions, Chen and Chen published this jewel paper, as I said, which shows that also a functional can be approximated with arbitrary accuracy universally with a single layer, okay? And it can be also extended to multi-dimensions. So doing that, then is how you implement that. It's a time series. So when you have time series, you go to recurring neural network. So we actually use a standard LSTM to demonstrate that with different stochastic inputs, if you train this efficiently, and it takes a few months because these computations are very expensive. I wasn't able to do that with my students at Brown. I did with some collaborators at MIT. And anyway, so you can find that, let's say, there's 3-6 degrees of freedom of this, and very quickly for a given stochastic approximation, stochastic excitation, you can find that in 0.01 seconds, you can predict what you would otherwise do for all degrees of freedom with about a week. So that then posed the question, can we extend this? Can we use neural networks to approximate operators? And by operators here, I mean any PDE operators, any black boxes and so on. So here I show you a schematic of learning math, for example, learning integration, learning Laplace transforms, learning PDEs, learning ODEs using this deep operator regression network that I want to talk about. Now, going from function to operator is not as simple as you can appreciate, because when we do image classification, for example, we go from a finite dimensional space to another finite dimensional space. However, doing operator approximation, we have to go from an infinite dimensional space to an infinite dimensional space. So you have to think a little different. And again, I found, amazingly, that Chen and Chen had produced another theorem that will give us rigorous mathematical evidence that we can construct neural networks. They didn't tell us how, but they gave us a universal approximation theorem for nonlinear operators. So this theorem here shows that indeed a nonlinear operator g of u, y is the output, can be approximated with arbitrary accuracy, even with a single neural network, okay? And what you see here is sigma is the activation function, so you can appreciate that this is a neural network that takes an input u, which is now a neural network, and the output y, the output space, because I have to have a continuous output. And with this expansion, you can approximate this function. So what we did is to first realize this in practice. So basically, we constructed a neural network, a feed-forward neural network for the input. So u is the input, so you sample it at n points. How you represent the input space is very, very important. And then you have the trunk, which will give you the continuous output, which is these parts, and then you cross them like that. Now, there are other manifestations of this, but let's stay with this. So unfortunately, while the theory is good, because you're learning operators you have what's called the Kirchhoff dimensionality of the input. In other words, it may take an infinite number of measurements to be able to realize this approximation. So what we did is to extend the theorem to deep neural networks, and this is what you have here. Okay, so this is now a deep neural network that substitutes a single layer and so on. So we have theory that shows that. I will talk about that later. But just for everybody to understand what's going on, we try to map from U to G of U. G is a nonlinear continuous operator. And we do the training. This is like supervised training. And like here on panel B, you can see what's going on. I have a lot of points and I just record one experiment for that input. Or two experiments here. And then I do it 10,000 times. And then after that, you will ask me the question, if I give you a new excitation, unseen data, new data, can you give me the answer? And of course, what's the accuracy and so on. So let's do a very simple example of integration. We've done also Laplace transforms and so on. For example, here we take this function, the integrand, and we map it to S of X. Notice that x here is from 0 to 1, but it could be also from 0 to infinity to do Laplace transforms. So what we do here, we take 10,000 integrands, and we evaluate the integral only at one point, x naught. That's why it says one training point. So basically, we do 10,000 training points. And as you can see here, the mean square error versus the number of iterations achieves very good accuracy, close to single arithmetic machine accuracy. If you compare this depot net, this structure with other like the standard feed forward or CNN or LSTM and so on, you can see our generalization error is very small, the difference between the training and the testing. So you can justify this choice. It's not the only choice, but it's a good choice. A surprising result was that when we try this on PDEs and ODEs, this is a couple ODE, this is the input, S1, S2 are the outputs. It's a two pendula coupled. We find that if you plot the error again versus the training data, we find exponential convergence. And we try different sizes of neural networks. As you can see, the exponential convergence turns into algebraic convergence here. And there is a break-even point where that happens. And that depends on the size of the architecture. So we cannot realize the exponential convergence, which is very desirable, right? Because you learn the operator very quickly throughout all the training regime. But apparently, what this evidence predicts, and we verify it later, much later with a theory, is that indeed this construction can give you, for certain mild conditions, exponential convergence of learning the operator, which is, of course, tremendous. I'm interested in fractional PDEs and fractional operators because they're more expressive, like just neural networks are more expressive. So my first reaction was, can we learn fractional operators, Laplacians and so on? So I want to demonstrate for the Caputo derivative. So I take a bunch of functions and I know how to differentiate them. So this is, as I said, supervised learning, you write the loss function. But again, you bring in the branch, you need the function, then you need the output space where you want this answer to be the derivative. And you can get pretty good results very quickly. The reason I show you this in particular is to show that, so the input space is very important, where you draw functions to do this training. And typically what we do, which actually violates the theorem, the proof of the theorem, because the input space has to be a compact space, we use GRF, Gauss random fields. And this gives you good accuracy. But in this particular case, I use a spectral representation of the inputs using Legendre or something else that they have developed, some Jacobi polyfractonomials. So that space is much more expensive. And if you do that, then you can see that you can have a improvement by an order of magnitude by improving the input space. Okay, so let me continue on that. We can learn stochastic PDEs, for example. So now this is a case where we take this coefficient here, which is, and I map it to the solution Y of X. So G now is a multi-dimensional, it will be a multi, so we have more dimensions. Depending on how correlated this process, I make this relatively correlated stochastic process. so I can truncate to only five modes in my Karhoen-Loeb expansion for the stochastic input. So that now goes into new coordinates, new inputs to the branch, and then the trunk space is six dimensional, five plus one, because it's in one. I use 1D here in space. And if you compare with let's say Monte Carlo or some other methods like polynomial chaos, and generalized polynomial chaos is one of my favorite methods, you can find that not only the statistics are right, but even individual realizations, if you use the same seed, and here I have 10 different realizations, it's very good with, we can predict that. The difference is that after you train the network in 0.01 second, no matter how difficult the problem is, you actually can get good results. Okay, so since we published the paper in Nature, we published this paper in 2019, and then a year later was published in Nature Machine Intelligence. But now we have produced this Sid Misra at ETH has done some tremendous work with his student. And it's 113 pages paper, which justifies some of the empirical observations that we have seen. It also removes the constraint of a compact input spaces. It extends this to measurable operators, so you don't have to have actually continuity. And it also gives you error estimates and tells you that how to do the sampling of the input space. It shows that how you choose even the random choice of sensor points to sample the input space is almost an optimal case. DeepMind like this DeepoNet a lot. And they wrote a two-page paper to praise this. They said also we can use it for social dynamics. And as they pointed out, and it's true, you can train this using experimental data, which can span multiple orders of magnitude, or simulated data. In fact, you can put in the loss function during training, you can put also the physics, the pins. Pins can go to the loss function during training, but of course you train it over many, many different boundary conditions, initial conditions, forcing terms. And then after you do that offline, online, you have this hugely over-parameterized network that can generalize to new cases. DeepoNet is blazingly fast next to numerical solvers, Quantum Magazine said, and so on. There's a lot of hype. My program manager likes it, but recently some people from Caltech wrote a very good paper on a Fourier version of operator regression using a Fourier basis and they don't have a trunk like we have, so they have to represent differently the output space. But we took the task recently, the upcoming paper, to do a comprehensive and fair comparison of DeepoNet versus what they call the Fourier neural operator. And we have some results on 17 real problems. I want to show you something because, as you can see here, our paper was published, and there was not much hype in the beginning. There's a little hype now, which I don't like it. But this MIT Technology Review wrote about FNO that is basically can solve everything, including turbulence, which I actually resent. So I did some tests. We did some tests here on simple problems. Like let's say you solve an advection problem using this as initial condition. You know that if it's a linear advection, this waveform will be there forever. So it's a good benchmark to check, and as you can see here, this case FNO gives you an error of almost 40% for these solutions. We looked at you can make FNO look like a DeepoNet, and then the accuracy will be smaller, better, but still bigger error. We look at a real problem that we're doing hypersonics for the DARPA. So we have a flow and we have some disturbance. And we want to find downstream what happens. If I write down the equations for hypersonic problems, where there's dissociation, chemistry, seven different fields, extremely small time scales because of the non-equilibrium chemistry, it's a very, very messy proposition. So basically the idea is here to use DeepoNet on the fly, literally a hypersonic speed, Mach number 10. You want to see what's going on downstream, let's say on your hypersonic vehicle. So we did some comparisons here. And in fact, if this environment is sterilized, a deponent is this, and FNO is this one, actually an extension of FNO. We can even use a CNN for this case. But if you put 0.1 noise, 0.1% noise, notice what happens to CNN and notice what happened to FNO. They're not robust at all because these are very nice concepts, but they work nicely for only for a sterilized environments. Deponet, as you can see here, suffers very, very little because of the noise. If you like all this stuff, we have a library which has been downloaded 170,000 times from GitHub. DeepXD, X stands for any differential equation. There's a similar, this has also operator regression, a library. I know that Ulysses and his group have developed a nice library, I believe in Julia, or I don't remember what, but there's a sufficient open software around that one can start. We have also a geometry module, but there's a lot going on right now in the community. I just want to say that I started this journey on physics informed learning about 6 years ago. People didn't believe it. Eventually, DOE gave us some money to start the center. And also now we have a MURI. The ongoing work now that we have is to actually automate the process of tuning this using meta learning, both for pins and also for deponent. And I think with that, I like to stop here and have plenty of time for answering your questions.
Thanks, George. That was really impressive. You know, the ship, I need to learn more about the ship, how you do that. You know, I'm sure you're using some very nice water wave theory there. But so we have time for questions. Anyone?
Yeah. What kind of, I noticed there are some activation functions involved here. One of them is the sigmoidal, but there are plenty of others that you can use. Is there any difference, or do you use them, or, you know, I'm just listening to this, what you're presenting, so I'm not sure how it all goes. But what are you using for this?
Yeah, thanks for that's actually something that we. So I presented here just physics related, but in the background we do a lot of developments on fundamental neural networks. One of them was actually to come up with this idea of adaptive activation functions. So, we have several papers of that, including theory. So we started with saying, you know, you can have it like hyperbolic tangents, you can have sines, you can have anything non-polynomial, but we parameterize them. So imagine like the hyperbolic tangent, I parameterize it so that each neuron will have its own firing rate and its own slope. So that also becomes, just like I talked about the trainable weights that Ulysses introduced, we introduce this parameter as a trainable parameter. So the data will decide when you fire the neuron at what rate and so on. You can do that for ELU and so on. The most recent update on that is that we introduce what we call them the rowdy activation functions. The reason for that is, so if you imagine the hyperbolic tangent, that's fine, right? But actually, we have exploding gradients at the plus one or minus one. We have vanishing gradients. It's not just the slope, which is important. It's also this plateau. So what we did, we put noise there through sinusoids. So we superimpose on the hyperbolic tangent. We superimpose like 3-4 more modes, Fourier modes, which we learn from the data. And if you do that, and we let them evolve, right? So these are trainable weights. If we do that, then we can actually solve what is called here the spectral bias. Spectral bias is because neural networks, as you may know, just like Fourier methods, like to learn the low frequencies first, and then they stop. But you know, imagine you have electromagnetic problem and you have 5 megahertz range. How would you get there? So the Rowdy activation function, we have a theorem on that. It's on the archive. It shows that if you have Rowdy activation functions and these adaptive activation functions, you will never run into a bad minima. That doesn't mean that you...
That's remarkable, actually.
It is remarkable, but it doesn't say that you will go to the global minimum, but you're not going to go to bad minima. In other words, you're not going to be stuck somewhere in remote Texas forever. You will be able to travel somehow to go somewhere. Now, if you go to the best place, I don't know, but you're not going to get stuck. That's important. So this, you know, this plateau that you see for a long time, you will not have. Yeah. So especially for high frequency problems, which actually Ulysses' clever literally idea addresses, the Rowdy activation function also address naturally, and they evolve. I have a nice picture of that, but I don't have it in this presentation. I forgot to say also in this hackathon problem, we use the adaptive activation function, which other groups didn't have. Yeah, because they have a little noise, for example, the ultrasound data, it will make you get stuck somewhere. And that was one of the problems also, that this the people thought that they didn't have enough data. The data was actually enough, but it was a bad minimum. So yes, so my collaborator Kenzie Kasowatsi is worked from CSAIL at MIT, and he proved basically the theorem. We have it on the archive.
Okay, I want to look at the archive. This is very interesting. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
More questions?
I have one real quick, if I may, Dr. Braganetto. Hey, Dr. Uh-huh. Karniadakis, thanks for coming out. I appreciate you giving the shout out to the self-adaptive pin. That means a lot. You're very kind. So I did have a question for you as we've been discussing things here at A&M. So in regards to funding agencies, you mentioned a lot of conversations with DARPA and DOE. Are they more interested in solving forward problems using things like the X-pin or self-adaptive pins? Or are they more interested in, you know, like the depot net type inverse problems that, I guess it's problem dependent, right? But are you seeing more interest in inverse or forward problems?
I mean, it's hard to tell. It's hard to tell because, like the hypersonics, for example, you don't know. There's no way you can know everything. Specifically for the hypersonics, because my program manager told me that today he told me. That he talked to, he presented this to all the directors of DARPA, and then they sent this to the Undersecretary of Defense for Science and Engineering, because we demonstrate to them that we can run this 100,000 times faster than the CFD solver. Okay, now they said why they are interested. They're interested because they said that they're going to have like 100 sensors on the wings or on the body of this airfoil, which are surface sensors. So we demonstrated in one of our papers that from the pressure sensors, you can solve the inverse problem, and that goes back to your question. So we can see what is the inflow disturbance, because, you know, when you fly out there at these high speeds, if you don't know what this flow is coming in, there's no way you can simulate anything, even with the best DNS. So we solve the, using the pressure transducers, like a dozen of them, you can sense what is coming from the inflow. Then using the forward depot net, now you can predict what's going on downstream. So it's not like it's not a dilemma, the forward or the inverse. And I always see it like as a continuous in this formulation. When you think of the how we weight the physics and the data, right? If the physics is less, that's like more than inverse problem, or if the physics is more, this is like a forward, but it's really a hybrid. So it's a continuum of problems. So I like to think that way. And I think most of the applications that that certainly the DOD has, but also I work with one of our inventions is we improved the head and shoulders shampoo for Procter & Gamble using a mixture of models. A cocktail of non-Newtonian models and the data that they have, proprietary data they have for viscosity. I never knew, you know, that shampoos are so complex materials, but they have nanoparticles, they have surfactants, they have all sort of crazy stuff there, aromatic things. And anyway, so this was, again, is a kind of inverse or hybrid problem, because they have data. And also we had models, but the models were not perfect. And we're trying to infer what happens to the viscosity as a function of the aging of the shampoo or a temperature and so or the the temperature. So I'm just saying that as a pedestrian example, which was like, you know, consumer products that you, what drives all this is not, of course, a homework. It's a really, it's really a real, you know, what the people want, right? Yeah. ANSYS, I work with ANSYS and they want to replace their expensive finite element parts with pre-trained networks. So you do finite elements, but they don't want to do the cost of refinement and so on. So you have this, even the all this stiffness assembly metrics, because you don't have to redo that and so on. If you have pre-trained networks, then all these refinements can be done under the hood very quickly without extra cost, because all these things over the years have been great, except their customers, they say they don't want to use them because it's expensive. So better to see pretty colors than correct answers. So in some sense, people are trying to be creative in different ways to see how this could be used. There's a long way to go, but I would say that just to concisely to answer your question, I would say hybrid problems are of interest.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. All right. I appreciate your time. And thanks again for coming out, and I really enjoyed your talk. Thank you.
Sure.
Any other questions? I think we still have a little time for one more question. So if not, then, I really would like to thank George again. It was an outstanding talk. We are very appreciative, George. And hope you, when this is all over, we'll be able to have you physically here to visit us. So thanks a lot. And
thank you very much. I see on the chat if the recording will be available. I guess you can answer that question, Ulysses. And
yes, the recording will be available on the SciML website.
I hope you like my slide with the clever Ulysses and the Trojan horse.
Odysseus, right? Odysseus. Yes.
And I use this black and white, right, to make it more.
Yes. Well, I hope I don't spend 10 years in the wilderness. But,
I guess. No, but research is like that. So
yeah, a little bit. Yeah.
It's better to do that. And
I know that.
Thank you all for your attention.
Thank you, George.
Have a good day. Bye bye.
See you again.